Weisz from McGill, who was visiting us here in Ilan and in Israel. Before I say a few personal words, I'll just tell you a bit about him. George Weisz is the Cotton Hanna Chair of the History of Medicine at the University of McGill. He's spent a long and illustrious career writing principally about healthcare in Europe and North America in the modern period, namely 19th, 20th, and now 21st century. He's written a number of books. His most recent ones are Chronic Disease in the 20th Century History, which came out about 3 years ago. Divide and Conquer, a Comparative History of Medical Specialization from 1830 to 1950. He's also been interested in institutional history, so he's written about the creation of French universities during the Third Republic, and also the Paris Academy of Medicine in the 19th century. He's, as you can tell, the issues that he's dealing with are large issues, never small, and sort of side issues. He's edited quite a large number of books, including including Healing the World's Children, Interdisciplinary Perspectives on Health in the 20th Century, The History and Sociology of Quantification in Medicine, which came out in 2006, Holism in Biomedicine, and a book called The Organization of Science and Technology in France, 1808-1914, together with my former teacher at Oxford, Robert Fox. George is now currently working on national and international efforts to organize effective primary care and trends in medical education. Specifically, what he'll be talking about today is global health and the history of global health. He is the 1998 recipient of the Burroughs Wellcome Fund 40th Anniversary Career Award in the History of Medicine and Science. On a more personal note, the reason I know George is because he and his colleagues invited me to McGill last year when I was spending the year in Boston, and I think it was April, but it was snowing. It was snowing.
Yeah.
It's Canada. And at the end of the talk, and Alan Young was my host as well, I just learned is here in Israel teaching a course at Tel Aviv University. But at the end of my talk, they insisted, the entire posse insisted that I taste a Montreal bagel. And it was snowing out. And we all crammed into this tiny car, and we went and they had this delicious bagel. They wouldn't let me leave the city without having tasted it. And this was the photo that we took. And so I sent it to a friend. He said he looks like an Abercrombie and Fitch good-looking dudes. What that?
Was it water bagel?
Was it water bagel?
It would have been the Park Avenue bagel.
It was pretty delicious. Anyways, it's a great pleasure and honor to reciprocate your invitation and to have you with us today.
As you can guess, we're inordinately proud of our bagels in Montreal. First of all, thank you for this lovely poster, which I've appropriated for my presentation. It's nicer than the one that I had before. Okay, I gave a talk on, I guess it was Thursday, at Tel Aviv on the history of global health, and it was to the Ethics Center. And I made the assumption that they knew absolutely nothing about global health, which was entirely correct. And so I talked about the large issues. I talked about a variety of events that took place in the 1990s, the AIDS epidemic, terror of rising infectious diseases mixed in with bioterrorism, the introduction of very rich people and their willingness to spend large amounts of money on global health. I talked about those kinds of big issues that mainly took place in the 1990s. Today I'd like to talk about something. I'd like to go back in time somewhat. And in order to make the argument that to understand much of what's going on in global health, you have to take a look at what was going on in international health research. And international health research was in many ways at the root of some of the seminal ideas that the money that came in the late 1990s, early 2000s, allowed to develop. So my central question is, why does global health explode in the 1990s and 2000s? This is from a paper that we've just had accepted from Biosocieties by Biosocieties, where we took a look at the entire corpus of global health literature in PubMed. And you have to do that because there's no way you can search for global health. It's multi-semic. 30%, if you do a search, 30% of your results are going to be quality of life instruments. Global health as a category in quality of life. So PubMed has a mesh term. It used to be World Health. They just switched it a year ago to Global Health. And you can see, and there's no metadata, so we had to find metadata on Web of Science so that we could look at citations and sort of map out this one. But the key thing here, I'm going to talk a little bit about this at the end, but the key thing here is you can see this incredible rise in the number of publications that are cited in PubMed in global health. And if you look over here, you'll see external funding for global health. And you see a very, very similar kind of pattern of, in the late 1990s, there's just an explosion. And if you take a look at institutions, global health institutions, this is something that some political scientists came up with to try to explain the pattern of global health institutions. Now, it's nonsense, okay? This is absolute nonsense. But the point is, it gives you some idea of the complexity of institutions that these people are trying to explain and to rationalize in some sort of way. Okay, so this is what happens in the 1990s, but I'm gonna start somewhat earlier. Well, even before I go back, let me go back to 1992-93. 1992-93 was a very big year for healthcare reform. This was the year when about a year of discussion about creating a health insurance system went on in the United States. In the UK, there were major projects of reform, trying to rationalize budgeting, trying to rationalize the way healthcare took place. And in general, it's fair to say that reform was in the air in Western nations. And the key question everywhere was, how do we set priorities? And how do we know what are effective solutions? What are effective measures to deal with those priorities? And to give you an idea of what happened, and I think things have gone a little screwy here. Okay, this is what I wanted to show you. So in 1992, some of you may remember this article. This was the first article in JAMA that introduced evidence-based medicine. Okay, November the 4th, 1992. It was a series of, I think turned out to be 28 or 32 articles on evidence-based medicine, a new paradigm for medical practice that's emerging. Several months later, this book came out, the World Development Report came out, almost exactly at the same time. And this book is important for a lot of reasons. It's been given a lot of, it's probably the most significant publication in the history of global health. But one of the reasons that is particularly interesting is that one of its key arguments was that you needed proper metrics in order to have evidence-based global health action. And it introduces the data from the Global Burden of Disease study, which was an attempt to create a measure, the DALY, the Disability Adjusted Life Year, that would combine morbidity and mortality data. But this wasn't the first. QALYs emerged in kind of health research in the 70s. Various efforts were made, but the DALY was introduced here, and it's, in my view, no coincidence that it's a few months after evidence-based medicine appears. Okay, so a year after the World Health Report appears, the actual Global Burden of Disease studies are published. In 1994, preliminary studies are published in The Lancet. In 96, the actual report itself is published. And then in 1997, four articles in The Lancet, which are among the most highly cited articles in the entire global health literature, with well over 2,000 citations each, are published. Two guys are responsible for, I mean, there's a whole group of people, but Chris Murray, who was at Harvard, at the Harvard Population Center, was really the critical person behind this, and you get suddenly an evidence-based form of, at least a claim of evidence-based global health. Okay. So this is the 90s, and what I want to argue is that this is the culmination of a process that begins in the 1970s. It's a culmination of a process that results from two developments. The first is the rise of tropical disease research in the 1970s, which from a tiny, tiny sector suddenly develops an inordinate amount of support from philanthropies and from governments. And the second one is something that, if you know anything about global health, you may have heard about, the debate between primary health care and selective primary health care that broke out in the late 1970s after the Alma Ata declaration was produced. Okay, so let me talk about each of these in turn. The WHO has always had a mandate to do scientific research. It's had an advisory committee since 1958. In 1974, there was serious intensification of this research interest. The advisory committee, advisory committees were set up in the six regions, the six WHO regions, to coordinate research that was taking place in the Asia region, the African region, the Middle East region, etc. Very, very importantly, the WHO set up a special program for tropical disease research, which I will talk about in some detail. And a number of foundations, the McConnell Foundation, started a program in tropical disease research in 74. And in 1978, the Rockefeller Foundation started what was probably the biggest program of the sort, the Great Neglected Disease Program, which basically focused on six of the major tropical diseases. Six of the major tropical diseases. Now, what united all of these institutions and developments? Well, first of all, the feeling that tropical disease was being ignored because it affected mainly poor countries. Who suffers from parasites and diseases of this sort? It was the poorest countries, and there was a general feeling that equity and social justice demanded that what were often the leading diseases in these countries be dealt with. In addition to that, there was a revolution in molecular biology that allowed tropical disease specialists to think, maybe we can manipulate parasites in a molecular way to create new kinds of vaccines, new kinds of pharmaceutical medications. So there was tremendous hope that was based on this new molecular biology. And the model for it, cited constantly, was the Green Revolution in architecture. And they specifically cite the consultative, what everyone has come to call CGR, the Consultative Group for International Agricultural Research, that immensely, through collective action of scientists, immensely expanded the ability to produce food all across the world. So tropical disease was very, very much based on this model of the Green Revolution. So let me just talk very, very briefly. One of the smaller programs was a very tiny little foundation called the McConnell Foundation. They didn't quite know what to do with the little bit of money that they had, and it was decided that one way that they could actually spend the money productively was in an area where very, very little money was being spent, and that was tropical disease research. And as you see, in about 24 years, they basically granted only about $90 million, focusing on three major tropical diseases. But it was very important because a lot of groups mobilized around the McConnell Foundation. A lot of groups mobilized. A much more important program, one that's actually just been the subject of a book, is the Great Neglected Disease the Rockefeller Foundation, rather, started in 1978. A guy named Kenneth Warren, whose name will come up several times as we proceed. Basically, what it did is it created a network of scientists who were not necessarily parasitologists. They were all over the place. The idea was they would be given money for 8 years to work on problems of tropical disease. And it seems to have been very successful. I say seems because Warren was a controversial guy, and he took credit for a lot of developments that other people thought maybe he didn't deserve credit for. But this was, in any case, a really major program that brought together a whole lot of people who had not worked on tropical disease before, but were now working very seriously on tropical disease. But the most important group that I want to talk about is the one that the WHO set up itself, and that was the Special Program for Tropical Disease Research. Now, this was a model for what would become global health in a number of ways. First of all, it was a partnership between a number of different groups that until then had not very frequently worked together. The WHO, the World Bank, and the United Nations Development Program. It was also unique in that it received most of its money from outside of the WHO regular budget. In other words, people sponsored it directly. By the 1990s, everybody was extraordinarily upset by this outside funding because it meant that sponsors were defining the programs of the WHO rather than the WHO itself, because its regular budget was being overwhelmed by these outside donations. But in the 1970s, when the WHO was seriously underfunded, getting money specifically for these projects seemed like a terrific idea. And one of the reasons that they went ahead with this was precisely in order to expand resources for science in this area. Another area in which they were extremely innovative, does this thing have a light?
The top one.
The top one? Was they actually work with pharma companies to create a large number of pharmaceutical products that could be used for either vaccinations to prevent diseases or to mitigate or cure diseases. And at least a dozen, 13 or 14 major products came out of this. Finally, one of the major issues of global health during the 1970s was developing research capacity in client countries. There was always a debate about what is the best place to do research. Do you do research at Harvard, where they have all of the infrastructure, or do you actually do research in Uganda, so that countries have some sort of research capacity, maybe not to do path-breaking, molecular research, but to do clinical trials and to do various sorts of things that enable a country to take some control over its health future. So they devoted a quarter of their budget to developing research capacity. And third, and next to last, they were among the first to recognize that if you were going to introduce research and innovation into poor countries, you needed more than biomedicine. You needed social sciences. You needed to understand the cultural and social factors that led to disease, that produced health, that led to a population's willingness to adapt certain kinds of technologies that they might not necessarily have accepted. And last but not least, they develop a unique culture within the WHO, a culture that's really very different from the mainstream culture of scientists who were off doing whatever they were doing. These guys were willing to work with industry. They were willing to work with large groups of agencies. It was a new vision of how research should take place.
But isn't part of the problem that industry wasn't all that interested in working with them? Because they're completely disincentivized to pour money into poor countries.
You're absolutely right. And one of their great successes is that they managed to work with most of the major pharma companies in order to actually get some very serious results. And they were one of the few international health institutions that could make this sort of claim, and that the pharmaceutical companies trusted. And there were two directors of it. One was Ade Lucas, who was a Nigerian, but who really spent most of his time at Harvard, but he was Nigerian, so they could say he was a third world figure. And Tora Godel, who succeeded, Lucas was director from 76 to 86, and Tora Godel was from 86 to 96, after which he went on to other things. Patricia Rosenfeld was in charge of their social science division, And she went on to the Carnegie Foundation, where she did some fairly important global health work. So this is a very, very important program. And the people that I am introducing here, we will come into contact with several times during the course of this discussion. Okay, so I mentioned that there was a second debate. There was a debate within the WHO about what international health should be about. And the key statement of that debate was the Alma Ata Declaration, which wasn't entirely new. Many of the ideas had been developed in the years before that. But it was a declaration that was developed at a large meeting in Alma Ata, in Kazakhstan, I believe. I'm not going to read the whole thing to you, but if you look closely at it, you will see a lot of language of social justice, equity, self-reliance, self-determination of countries, a new international economic order. It basically called for vast changes in the health systems of poor countries in the world, largely paid for by rich countries. But focusing on primary health, on creating health structures within countries that dealt with the most common problems faced by those countries, so that there would be structures to deal with health, as opposed to parachuting in people from the Western world to, let's say, eradicate malaria, eradicate mosquitoes. Okay, that would be a kind of a vertical version, or having teams going through the countryside doing vasectomies in order to promote birth control. The vision here was creating real health systems, and because health systems are expensive, they saw the way to say, first of all, they expected the Western countries to pay a lot more money than they were paying, but they were also willing to compromise on the education of physicians. And they very much saw the barefoot doctors of China as kind of a model for this kind of healthcare system that dealt at a population level with the most common problems of poor populations. Well, about a year later, there was one of numerous meetings in Bellagio organized by the Rockefeller Foundation. And I don't know if this is actually big enough for you to see this. Can you actually read that, or is that to
Selective
Primary Care? Julia Walsh was a young MD at Harvard, and Kenneth Warren, you may remember, from the global tropical disease, the great tropical disease thing. Anyway, there were a bunch of papers. This was one paper that basically argued that the Alma Ata Declaration was unrealistic. There was no money to do this. What you really had to do was focus on three or four key issues and really do them properly. Initially, the paper was largely ignored. All of the papers were published in 1979 in Social Science and Medicine, and the editor didn't even mention this paper. He didn't even mention this paper in his editorial introduction. But very soon, it was, this is Julia Walsh, and there's Kenneth Warren again. Very soon, it was picked up by a large number of agencies, particularly UNICEF, but also the World Bank and USAID. And as you can see, it was particularly popular among tropical disease people, because tropical disease people do think about specific diseases, targeting specific problems, specific diseases, rather than in terms of health systems more generally. So this was picked up very, very widely. The argument was that primary health care, which would be the opposite, not currently feasible, rather than focusing on cheaper healthcare workers, focus on low-cost and proven effective measures directed against a few major problems. Now, they suggested four, but the major institutions basically focused on seven: growth monitoring, oral rehydration, breastfeeding and immunization, food supplementation, female literacy, and family planning. And this created intense conflict and controversy. Dozens of articles were written criticizing or defending selective primary care. Well, as almost always happens, the international health world was not interested in divisiveness, and they eventually came to a compromise. One of the compromises was the word selective disappeared from the literature. It just disappeared. People still meant only a few things, but the word selective disappeared. And at the same token, by the same token, people stopped talking about only five or six or seven interventions. They began talking about 25 or 30 major interventions, mainly in infectious and tropical disease, and what were the most cost-effective ways of dealing with all of these issues. So they expanded vastly the range of problems that could be dealt with. And of course, the issue was choosing priorities and the least expensive interventions. What did I just do here? Now, there were a lot of reasons why this happened. One of them was a desire to avoid fragmentation, and there were actual meetings where these things were negotiated. These things were negotiated and worked out. But also, there was a lot of agreement about a certain number of things. One area of agreement was that the very expensive technological medicine of the West was not appropriate in poor countries. But another thing that was in agreement, that whatever the goal, you needed to choose priority actions, and you needed research that helped you determine what those priority actions should be, as well as inventing solutions for those in which no solutions existed. So there was agreement that you needed both biomedical research to come up with new solutions, and you needed some form of social science or health services research so that it could actually be implemented. Now, the WHO was a huge institution, and TDR program was one part of it, which supported selective primary care very thoroughly. But there was another part of it. There was an advisory committee on health research. It was originally medical research. It became, in 1986, advisory committee on health research. And who did they get to write their report on a health research strategy? But Thomas McEwen. Have people heard of Thomas McEwen? Is this a name that historians know all about Thomas McEwen? Because he wrote a book in 1976 called The Role of Medicine, in which he basically argued that the declines in mortality in the 19th and 20th century were not due to medical intervention. They were due to improvements in the quality of life, and particularly nutrition, and to a somewhat lesser degree, improvements in sanitation. And this, at the time, was a really, really big... We historians of medicine don't have a lot of big debates. This was a big debate among historians of medicine and among policy people, because there were serious implications. The implications for the West was that you did not invest a lot of money in high technology hospital medicine, because this is not how mortality declined. Anyway, again, you can't see it. It's a little bit small here. But he wrote a report, many versions of which existed. This is the 1986 version that I found at the WHO. It was rewritten several times, but its basic argument was fairly clear and not surprising to anybody who read his book. Health could be, disease could be prevented by modifications of ways of life, in this context, environment and behavior. In other words, people had to exercise and eat well, and they needed to have clean water. Nutrition and population control headed the list. Safe water and sanitation, economic growth, and therapeutic services would become more important in the future. Again, given the importance of tropical medicine, diseases of the tropics were an exception and needed special research because they did not respond directly to living standards.
What happened to female literacy, which existed in the seven primary ones? That seemed pretty promising.
Yes, it seemed promising, but
still is probably the most promising.
This was not one of his immediate priorities. Birth control, which might depend to some degree on female literacy, was his. And by the way, female literacy, one of the goals was actually birth control, or at least family planning. So for him, nutrition and population control headed the list, and female literacy would have probably fit in as a kind of a methodology for population control. So what happens? The people who do selective primary care, Walsh and Warren, they begin to write books about how to establish health priorities in the developing world. And a whole bunch of them are created. A whole bunch of these books are published. What they're all missing is a mechanism. You can talk about establishing priorities, but something is missing, and that is what it is exactly that you're going to count in order to establish priorities. Meanwhile, the tropical disease people are not being quiet. The tropical disease people convince, and this is the American Tropical Medicine Association, convinces the Institute of Medicine, which is part of the National Academy of Science, to do a study on the US capacity to address tropical disease problems. And if you look carefully, a couple of names that are important here, David Bell, who's chair of population studies at the Harvard School of Public Health, and who we'll come back to in a moment. And of course, Kenneth Warren is one of the key advisors of this. So the United States is taking up the challenge of a tropical disease. There's actually another study that comes out at the same time. The Office of Technology Assessment is also doing a major study on tropical disease for their own rather different reasons. But tropical diseases are a major figure. Okay, so what happens? Cook, at one of these many Bellagio meetings, where you get the feeling that everybody knew each other by the first names, and they smoked cigars together, and they drank scotch, and they had a grand old time looking at this beautiful lake. Cook proposes at, actually it was a Clark Foundation meeting, to organize a big study on tropical disease. And somebody said, nobody knows who, hey, why just limit ourselves to tropical disease? Let's do something on research in general, on health research for development. And so a task force was set up, which published a very, very consequential report in 1990 that argued that research funds were not being used to deal with the health problems of the majority of the world's population. This the whole 1090 cliche about 10% of the world's population getting 90% of the world's medical research originates from this. So there's need for far greater resources and equity in distribution. But also one of the things that happens as you shift from tropical disease to research in general, there's much more emphasis on health services research in order to choose priorities and solutions. They don't give up on tropical disease research, but there's a lot more discussion. There's a lot more discussion about how it is that countries can decide on their health priorities. And the other point is that they take up the TDR's emphasis on development of research capacity in poorer countries as an article of faith, that this is what needs to happen. So what are the results of this? If you take a look at the commission sponsors, you see the original sponsors were some fairly unknown institute, the McConnell Clark Foundation, the German Research Foundation Canada actually played a rather important role. But by the end of it, almost everyone was involved in funding this organization, including the World Bank, the UNDP, the Swiss Development Corporation, you name it, the Rockefeller, everybody was involved in this project. And if you take a look at the Commission Secretariat, in fact, three secretariats were listed, but the main secretariat was at Harvard's Population Center. And in fact, I have the archives of the Rockefeller Foundation, which gave their money directly to Harvard and called it Harvard's Commission on Health Research for Development. Lincoln Chen, I don't think, was hired to be in charge of this project, but the applications to the Rockefeller Foundation said that he would be spending 4 or 5 months a year actually heading this project for the next few years. The Commission Secretariat is kind of interesting because three of its members, Bergstrom, Lucas, and Ramalin Gaswani, were members of the WHO TDR program. So you see the kind of direct connection. You see a lot of third world names here because they prided themselves that three quarters of the members of the commission came from poorer countries and not the West. And a member of the staff is Chris Murray, who for some reason is listed in New Zealand. But some of you may remember the name Chris Murray from the Global Burden of Disease project. So it turns out that just about the same time, in 1988, the WHO decides that it's going to have its own technical discussions on research strategy. And there's a big debate about whether they should include the discussion of the independent commission in their discussions, and in the end, they do. And so they come up with a variety of preliminary reports, and then in 1992, a summary of the discussions is produced. I cannot tell you about this because I just received this on interlibrary loan. McGill doesn't have it, but I just received this on interlibrary loan. My guess would be that it does not differ tremendously at this point from the independent commission, but that's just a guess. So what comes out of the, a number of things come out of this 1990 commission report. One of them is the creation of a new institution, CORED, the Council on Health Research for Development, which is a small institution that works directly with poor countries to set up research capacity and research institutions. And this is set up in Geneva, but it's independent of the WHO. And it asks, in at least twice, in 95 and in 94 and 96, to become recognized by the WHO as a cooperating institution, and it's turned down until 1998, when it's finally admitted as a cooperating institution. The other thing that happens is that there's a meeting in Ottawa where the World Bank and the WHO decide that what they really need is to partner on global health research. And the basis, they propose a review of internet health priorities in the light of the analytical framework proposed by the World Development Report of 1993. Remember that World Development Report of 1993 with its DALIs and with its evidence-based. It's decided that this should be the basis not just of programming, this should be the basis of setting research priorities. And here's, of course, the World Development Report with Dean Jameson. Most of us know it not so much because of the DALIs, because it's considered a neoliberal document, which I put in quotation marks. I don't think it's a, we can debate about it, but what it is, it's about donors getting together and making decisions about priorities and working together with multinational corporations. So in 1996, the Ad Hoc Committee on Health Research Relating to Future Intervention Options publishes a report, increased R&D funding, priorities based on economic rationality, size of problems determined by global burden of disease, DALIs, and very important, they argue for a new institution for exchanging ideas about progress and priorities in R&D, for tracking flow of funding, et cetera, et cetera. They, in other words, they argue for yet another institution outside of the WHO. And if you look at the authors of this document, you will see some very familiar faces. Dean Jameson is the chair of the committee, and the study co-director is Tor Godal, who is director of the special program on TDR. So a direct line over some 15 years between TDR and global health research. Now you still have the advisory, the WHO's Advisory Committee on Health Research, okay, who from the very beginning are very uncomfortable by this ad hoc committee. They are constantly asking to be shown the various documents that are produced. It's pretty clear that they insist that certain changes be made. What I need to do is contact some of the people who are still alive and try to get a hold of the early versions of this report to see what changes actually took place. But what's really interesting is that in the end, they focus on one thing, and that is the DALI. So here, a reported meeting of the Global Advisory Committee on Health Research. Again, I don't know why everything is so unclear on this one, but let me see if I can just read this for you. The committee reviewed the ACR. The committee recommended that it should be translated. Stated that such an issue should be brought to its attention and that it would provide timely advice to the Director General and through him to the governing bodies in accordance with its terms of reference. The committee recommended that it should be requested to peer review the ad hoc committee's report and intervention options before its publications. It obviously did not get to peer review them because One of the things that happens is that in 1997, they create their own report. They create their own report, and one of their major arguments is that the DALI is a very poor measure for decision making. And the people who created the DALI understood that it was an imperfect instrument. It was an imperfect instrument, first of all, because it was based on a huge number of estimates. Statistics from many parts of the world were very poor, so you had very, very sophisticated algorithms for, you know, that made them seem very real. But in the bulletin, they clearly distanced them. The other thing about the DALI is that in its original version, remember, it was written by economists. So they distinguished between age, between people of productive age and children and elderly people. So the deaths of children and elderly people weighed less than that of people of productive age. So people were very, very upset about that, which eventually Chris Murray got rid of. Chris Murray has been nothing but, if not pragmatic, in constantly adjusting to criticisms about this. So you see, the WHO as an institution takes its distance, and this is really incredible. This is the first of the 1997 Global Burden of Disease articles published in The Lancet. Okay? In the back, in the acknowledgments at the very end, it says, this work was supported by McConnell Clark, the Rockefeller, the World Bank, and the WHO. The views expressed are entirely those of the authors and do not reflect the opinions, policies, or standards of WHO. WHO considers that DALIs and the burden of disease approach discussed in these papers are potentially useful for health situation assessment, but require further research. So in a published article where they acknowledge support, they take their distance. Well, okay, this lasted about a year. Then the WHO gets a completely new administration. Gro Harlem Brundtland, a former prime minister of Norway, comes in with an entirely reform agenda. And who does she bring in to the WHO? She brings in Chris Murray, Dean Jameson, Richard Feachum, and Julio Frank, who had become associated, who actually had tried to implement the World Development Report in Mexico. She brings all of these people into the WHO. And so this explains one reason why the DALI has become the dominant metric. But it's not the only reason. And here, I've been speaking a little too long, so let me come to my conclusion. One of the reasons, besides institutional power, is the simplicity of the DALI. Okay? To me, it's not so simple, but to anybody who knows math, this is a relatively simple way of creating a single metric that enables you to do a lot of things. What can you do when you have a single metric? Well, you can create maps like this. You can create maps where you can show the number of DALIs, you know, standardized for a particular problem in different countries. It allows you to manipulate data in extraordinary ways. Or this is really funny. I showed this at a talk that I gave, and somebody raised their hand and said, "That's from an article that I wrote." You can take it and you can compare it with costs, probability of success, and you can manipulate this kind of very simple metric in extraordinary ways. Now, what did the WHO Advisory Committee suggest instead of the DALI? Let me show you what they suggested instead of the DALI. What they suggested was something called a visualization, what's it called here? Visual health information profile. Okay, now if you don't understand this, you're not the only one. I had to get a medical student to explain this one to me. Okay, basically, you start in the middle with 10, and you go down to 0. Okay? So, if something is a 10, which is child labor, things are very, very, very bad and something needs to be done about them. Crime and violence are pretty bad. First of all, if you take a look at it, it includes environmental determinants, food and nutrition, sociocultural characteristics, healthcare system, disease conditions. It tries to do everything. It tries to do everything and put it in some kind of visual field so that you can, for every year, you can collect data like this. Here's data from Tunisia from various years, so you can actually see what areas are improving, what areas are not. My first reaction is, who on earth can actually use this? Who on earth can actually use this? And when I first wrote this, my thinking was that this was a classical example of fundamental tension in any kind of attempt at quantification to create a single aggregate measure that is simple to use, but necessarily simple-minded because it leaves out so much. And an instrument that tries to do justice to complexity of health and disease, but which is really, really difficult to use. And then I read the ACHR report, and I realized that something even more fundamental was at stake. The DALI was essentially adopted by policy people who wanted to create priorities for policy. The advisory committee that came up with this visualization technique was written by scientists. It was written by scientists who, in fact, their report of 1997 is completely different from the ad hoc report. They don't talk at all about a global forum. They talk about creating networks of scientists around computers and what they call telecommunications. Their idea is that you can get networks of computers to work on particular problems thanks to the magic of telecommunications, what they call telekinetics, and about a half of their report is devoted to computers and what you can do with telekinetics and computers. So you have two completely different visions between what measures mean for policymakers and what measures mean for active scientists. And let me just say that the Global Forum was in fact created, and it has come out with a 1090 report on health research almost every year for the past few years. It is independent of the WHO, but with all of these institutions has some sort of vague connection with it. I would argue that, and this is my real argument here, that what we understand as global health, which is institution based on broad partnerships, particularly partnerships of donors, started in the health research field. And from health research, it went on to the Gavi Alliance and the Global Fund to fight AIDS, tuberculosis, and malaria. So the Global Forum may not have been the most effective or the richest of the new global health institutions, but it was definitely the first. Do I have 2 more minutes? Okay, then let me show you just one other thing, just to show you the importance. I showed you this. This is the database that we used to try to understand the world of global health publications. Now it's limited. PubMed is biomedical largely. It takes account of articles, not gray literature, So you have to be aware of its limitations. But again, I don't know why, I think it's the projection. This is a map of multi-authorship. Okay, well, all right. This is a map of multi-authorship. And what we did was, you know, this is a field in which we found 30,000 articles, and we took people who wrote at least 15 articles together. Okay? And so it's one of the things that holds together global health, the fact that people write things together. Now, if you'll notice, there is one particularly thick area in the middle. Does anybody want to guess what this thick area in the middle is?
This is a field? Or
this is a bunch of articles that are clustered together and that are connected with lines to other fields.
Mm-hmm.
Actually,
it has to have money. It has to have money.
Terrorists?
Well, yes, you're absolutely.
They get money to research it, probably.
Well, if you take a look, this is the literature on the global burden of disease. The people who did the global burden of disease were smart enough to connect. This is mental health, which, as you can see, has been making its case for its importance for more resources, largely by collaborating with the global burden of health people, in order to show what an incredible global burden of health mental disease is. So you see a really, really close connection, but you also see connections with almost everything. The global burden of disease has been collaborating with absolutely everybody to a greater or lesser extent, in making its statistics, its DALIs, useful for everyone. Now let me show you what I think is an even more interesting, and I wish you could actually read these things better. This is what really counts for me, is co-citations. That this co-citations is how you see the intellectual structure of a field. That if people are constantly citing two or three articles together, they come to make up some very, very serious clusters. Okay, this is, I haven't been able to explain why infectious disease, why am I going back, why is this?
Yeah.
Okay, infectious disease has become quite marginal, and I can't explain this. But let me just, if you take a look at the global health field, you see a lot of loosely connected areas ranging from mental health, maternal health, some connections between them. Global health education, which since 2007 has become a really, really big deal. McGill is creating a new school of population and global health, which shows you, I mean, McGill is 10 years behind everybody else, so you know, you can really tell how important this is becoming. But what holds together this whole thing is metrics. Metrics is the one, it's especially important for non-communicable diseases, because like mental health, much of their argument for increased spending on cancer and heart disease and diabetes is based on GBD metrics. So what you have is this really loose, heterogeneous domain of literature in which the center of which is metrics, not just the global burden of disease. There are some very important, there's one very, very important cancer survey. There are, in 2005, there was an important mental health survey, but the GBD keeps coming out regularly with data that can be used by everybody and that is used by everybody. So with that, I will end. Thank you.
Thank you very much, George. I think we'll open it up to questions. Nadav.
Thank you. This is fascinating. Wow, I don't know how to limit myself because I have a lot to say. I guess I have two comments or questions. One, I'd be very happy to hear how you connect your narrative to the pre-Second World War. Or if I can take, you know, Randy Packard or analysis, you know, raising from tropical medicine to international health to global health, because I know from your work, and I'm sure that, you know, things started before, and it's interesting because many times it's kind of neglected that many of ideas were already in the interwar period and kind of almost forgotten and like reemerging as something new, but, you know, we can find them before. So that's kind of a common question. The second aspect, I wonder how this whole fit in with the Cold War context that I think is also extremely important in some of these heated discussion about vertical, horizontal, primary care. I mean, it's not a coincidence it was in Alma Ata, etc.
No, it was the Russians.
Yeah, I know. So, and the whole question, you know, what kind of diseases we should eradicate, malaria versus smallpox, etc. So,
okay, in answer to your first question, on Thursday, when I spoke to medical ethicists, I gave them some historical background in which I talked about various forms of international collaboration, the international commissions on plagues and epidemics that begin in 1851. I talked about the commissions, the commission that created the international classification of disease in 1900, and every 10 years subsequently. And I talked about colonial medicine, which is obviously what has been left in many of these poor countries. This is what was inherited in the post-colonial period. I don't claim to be an expert on the League of Nations Health Organization, but I know that historians love it because it was so well-meaning. It had such lovely left-wing instincts, and it tried so hard to create social justice. My sense is that its influence was extremely limited in terms of what goes on in the post-war period. I could be wrong about this, but I think that the Cold War precisely created a really different political atmosphere for international health than the interwar period. I didn't talk very much about the Cold War, but there's no question Alma Ata was written by the non-aligned nations, and it talks about a new economic order. And there's no question that the foundations that are opposed to Alma Ata, partly because they consider it unrealistic, it doesn't necessarily, I suppose it is a Cold War battle, but it's also a battle of people who think in short-term, pragmatic terms, and people who think in very long-term, idealistic terms, where you're willing to wait a very long time for changes to occur. So the biggest effect of the Cold War, I think, was the emphasis on population control in the 50s and 60s. This is a really major thing, which is being not abandoned, but it's being changed. They know it's now called family planning. It's now called child and maternal health. It's no longer acceptable to talk about population control. That has a very, very retrograde, reactionary sound to it. As far as colonial medicine is concerned, there's no question. I mean, I've read Randy's book, and I'm not quite sure what to make of it, because on some level it's very, very good. You know, certain issues run through the entire history of this. The choice between creating health, strengthening health systems, and trying to eliminate specific diseases has been a choice that goes back well over 100 years. And I think it's a choice not for ideological reasons. I think those are basically the choices. And it's much easier I'm not sure how I want to say this. So there is a lot that has not changed. And Randy's book focuses very much on what has not changed. And I think he ignores what has changed. I think the sheer scope, I really believe that size and scope makes a tremendous difference. And when you have a few countries and their colonial empires, and a couple of international commissions, and the Rockefeller Foundation running international health, and you now have a total balagan of thousands of institutions, many of whom don't know what the other ones are doing, then I think you have a fundamentally different situation than you had 50 or 60 years ago. So without denying the continuities, that you know, that some of these choices are basic choices because they're so strategic. We don't have all that many choices. You know, the vertical versus the horizontal is one of those fundamental, elemental choices that we're going to have almost whatever happens. But to me, the context has become radically different.
First of all, thank you. It was really so thorough and rich lecture with all the junctions and people and the algorithms involved and everything. And it's a tough question, and if you find it irrelevant, you don't have to answer. But I was wondering what would be an alternative history? What would happen if junctions were different? Was there not global health? Would we not think of health as a global thing? Or would we not care about the third world, or would we? What was really the crucial thing that you think needs explanation?
Well, let me put it to this: you know, it's a terrible thing to say on one level, but I have friends in disability studies. And for them, it's unimaginable that the world does not adjust to people's disabilities. It's unimaginable, and it's unethical, and it's horrible. And personally, I agree with that. But as a historian, I ask another question. Since when have we as a world been concerned with people's disabilities and their ability to get around them? What is it about our society that suddenly makes it important that somebody in a wheelchair should be able to get downstairs? What has changed in our society? So I think you can ask a very similar kind of question about global health. I think, you know, the trouble with global health is that it's so big and it's so complex and it's so multi-layered that you could really point to so many different things, and it would probably take changes in two or three of them to make a difference, okay? So one thing that is clearly critical is we now do have some belief that we owe it to the poor people of the world to give them decent health care. People haven't always felt this way. This is an important cultural change, and it's made a tremendous difference in how we think about some of the poorest countries in the world. There's also a considerable amount of self-interest involved. We are terrified of the latest emerging disease. It's in our interest to try to suppress diseases in sub-Saharan Africa, because within hours, they can be at LaGuardia Airport or at Kennedy Airport. So we have very strong self-interest. Those interests aren't just about health. Countries that are suffering from serious disease burdens, we now have come, economists have now come to believe, have a much slower economic development. Well, if they have slower economic development, they can't be markets. They can't be markets for us. So, you know, nothing is inevitable. But I believe that any really big change has many factors behind it and cannot be reduced to a single one. A lot of things have to come together for a change of this magnitude to actually take place. So I don't know if I've answered your question, but it's the best I can do.
I wanted to ask you something about the growth in the mental health segment. The question of my research is why is the world exactly what you answered to Rela? Why is the world now so preoccupied with well-being and happiness? That's my research. And in my research, I see suddenly that the issue of mental health is growing. I even heard a lecture of somebody from the World Health Organization in a neuroscience conference. And he was talking about how important is digital technology going to be in the third world in mental health? So I think it's going to some extreme that I feel that the Western world is putting those issues on developing countries, which I don't know if they have the same rates or the same sources of depression or anxiety and other mental health issues. How do you explain this exponential growth in interest?
My explanation is, before I did this, I got into this because I was doing a book on chronic disease, and I became interested in why the World Health Organization becomes suddenly so interested in what they call non-communicable diseases around 2000. And my answer is, because a lot of this is generated in the West. A lot of this is generated in the West, in Western medical schools, and in Western medical schools, the majority of people do not do infectious diseases, they do non-communicable diseases, psychiatrists do not do infectious diseases, but a lot of this literature is generated in the West, either by professors in Western medical schools, or by their trainees, by trainees in third world countries who come and do training in North America and in Europe. I would guess that your average villager in Botswana does not think all that much about depression as a really serious issue. They might think about starvation before they thought about depression. On the other hand, your average professor of psychiatry in an American medical school will be concerned with things like depression psychosis and various other issues. So I guess my simple answer is that I think it starts in the West, but at a certain point, it's picked up by the natives. I mean, the natives pick up the dominant global health culture. Certainly all the big surveys that I've shown have been done by Western researchers. The big mental health survey of 2005 comes out of Harvard.
You can add to it, I think, the pharmaceutical companies, the involvement of pharmaceutical companies that are producing those antidepressants and are pushing it to be on the agenda constantly, right? So it's like it started with Prozac in the 80s, and I think Andrew Lakoff's book, first book on pharmaceuticals in Argentina can give some kind of answer.
That explains middle-level countries like Argentina and Brazil. But it's hard to imagine how many African countries can possibly afford to pay for these antidepressant drugs. Right. In fact, it's a constant source of tension. Is who exactly is going to pay for these things, and how much are pharmaceutical companies willing to sacrifice in order to make their drugs available to the really poorest countries?
Yes, I'll ask. So you kind of followed the institutional history of the growth of public health, and also an important metric for you in this study was the publication pattern. And I was wondering how your story would differ if you followed the money more carefully. And in particular, going back to this 90-10 rule, and the complete lack of an incentive on the part of private pharma companies to invest in third world countries. The drugs, a drug from development to design to the market takes on average something like 12 years or something like that. It costs an enormous amount of money. People in India don't have money for those drugs. And so I once heard actually OBE, CBE, DPhil, MA, whatever all his titles, Mr. Sykes of the Glaxo Wellcome Company at Oxford, give a talk, and he said, "I don't care about the third world; they don't have money for me." He said it point blank.
Oh,
I mean, they have voracious appetites; they're in it for the money. I mean, to be a little bit cynical, these companies are privately funded, and the investors want a return on their investment, and so on and so forth. So What I'm interested in is, if you take the total amount of money invested in drugs and pharma companies in the Western world and compare it to the amounts of money that we're talking about that are attached to some of these programs, can you give us a feel for the relative weight
of the
monies?
Nobody can really give you. I mean, there's a reason why 1090 has become a cliche. Nobody really believes that it's 10% and 90%, but it's a convenient way of describing extraordinary disproportion. Extraordinary disproportion. Now, one aspect of the disproportion that you're talking about and that is very, very real is the disincentive of pharmaceutical companies to produce drugs for very poor countries. Even when they have drugs, like for HIV, antiretrovirals for HIV/AIDS, it took years of campaigning. And that's what, when I give my sort of talk on why global health sort of erupted, this is one of the issues that made it a worldwide campaign. It took years until basically the drug companies were embarrassed into more or less giving away, and they're not even giving it away, anti-retroviral drugs. And there are many more drugs that do exist that are still not finding their way to sub-Saharan Africa or to the poorest parts of Asia. It's not even a matter of producing them, it's just a matter of being able to afford them. The irony, and I do and I talk about this more when I do my more general talk, the irony about having a metric like the DALI that shows that issues like mental health and non-communicable disease are major global burdens. The irony is, this does not show up in the funding. The funding remains largely what it was 10 years ago. HIV/AIDS, malaria, child and maternal care, certainly non-communicable, NCD funding has expanded, but at exactly the same rate as funding in general. And part of that may be pharmaceuticals, but part of that is that people are agencies are already committed to programs. You can't just suddenly take money away from HIV/AIDS and give it to heart disease. You know, there's a limited amount of money, and that money is largely committed. So that's a large part of the problem. And if you and I can show you. I mean, I have these graphs. The Institute for Health Metric Research that does the global burden of disease does follow the money actually pretty accurately. There's been remarkably little change in how money. There's been a big change in how money is, by whom money is distributed. But there's been very little change on for what issues it's distributed. That has remained remarkably stable. And that's partly because of the cost of pharmaceuticals, but it's also because in a limited resource setting, it's very hard to suddenly shift gears and take money away from something else. You know, the only way things could really change if the huge increase that took place between 2000 and 2008, if there had not been an economic crisis, and that had continued to rise at the level that it was rising, then maybe the proportions would be rather different. But because there's been a kind of a stabilization for the last 5 or 6 years, there's been remarkably little change.
And just a follow-up question: do you think that some of the emphasis on kind of programs of social intervention, things like female literacy and sanitation and so forth, is a result of a basic logic, which is an economic logic, which can't be overcome, that the diseases of the third world are just, you know, they're not economic from the point of view, you know, research and development for Western companies, and so therefore you push towards social solutions because these are more, you know, intervention is more practical, and you can't overcome the greater issue that which is a moral debate,
it's not even a moral debate. Since 1975, everyone has admitted that there are social causes of disease and environmental causes of disease. I don't know anybody who has denied that. Where there have been debates is whether it's more cost effective to change water or to vaccinate babies.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the debates, you know, tend to show up. But if you take a look at the research priorities that are coming out now, education of women is certainly a major factor. It covers a huge range of possible disease states. social scientists are not involved in global health in the way that they would like to be involved, especially the anthropologists, who feel really left out. The number of anthropology articles about how it's important to get anthropology more involved in global health is really very, very striking. But there certainly is a kind of a sense that whether it's 25% of the budget or 20% of the budget, you have to understand the society in which things are taking place in order for things to happen. That, I believe, is somewhat called into question by the Gates Foundation, by people like the Gates Foundation that are looking for technical solutions. You know, there are a lot of people out there with a lot of very different ideas of what the basic problems are and what the best solutions for them are. Gates likes quick technical solutions to relatively simply defined problems, and that's where he puts a lot of his money into. TDR started doing social science research in 1975. So yeah, but I think that's definitely part of the total picture.
If I have to one comment.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. There are two slides that you show, which are which are a nice demonstration for STS students. One is the visualization, you know, the diagram, the round diagram for Mexico versus the graph, the global health graph, and standardization, the part on standardization, right? But the one before it. Okay, so the two graphs or the two diagrams show the effectiveness of, you know, of inscription devices, and right, and how the more standardized you make these devices, the more global you can look at this phenomenon, right? So the round diagram is only in relation to one country. And it cannot be, it has to be three dimension,
absolutely,
right? It has to be three dimension diagram in order to reflect something that is more global. So this is one thing, and the other thing that I thought that is, I don't know, it is nice to look into it more than just one sentence, is the matrix. The matrix that you showed of the global health, which is associated with mental health and child care, and which is in the center of everything. So if you think in terms of Latour, Bruno Latour's term, so it can be a boundary object where everyone can use the term global health and give it a different emphasis, different content, but it remains global health, and also and it can also be some sort of obligatory passage point. So everyone needs to say something about global health in order to be counted, in order to be into the discussion. For example.
Absolutely, you know, at McGill, psychiatrists have only started talking about global mental health in the last 2 years. And that's because McGill is creating a school of population and mental health. I'm convinced.
Yeah.
I'm convinced. There's a reason why why social medicine in Harvard is now social medicine and global health. University of London, that big department, I forget what it used to be called, it's now Global Health. Nick Rose's department is now Department of Global Health. There are terms which achieve such power, such fashionableness, and I think fashion is the only way to describe it in if you want to be seen as relevant,
right.
you need to say global something.
You
right.
need to
right.
to make yourself fit in
right.
to that in one way or another. Absolutely.
So Latour calls it, titles it the obligatory passage point. You have to go through it in order to be considered. Thank you.
We have a small little gift for you, which it took the efforts of our student Billy, and we'll be making many more of these. But this cup says, "This specific formation of so-called atoms that we, as experts and as part of intricate social webs, tend to name a mug." And then it has the caffeine molecule, and it says Sunny by the caffeine, the STS program. So thank you very much.
Thank you.